the more I see tulips. Except this is not based on a perception of scarcity, but a belief in oversupply. It's incredibly ironic, and this is a key point, that those who love and loathe market economics totally embrace carbon trading, legislated carbon trading. I've met the epitome of the sandal-wearing, lentil-eating hippie at debates in Victoria and Otago universities. They look down at you as a despised capitalist, but then wax lyrical about how great carbon trading is. I just see tulips. What we do as farmers is real. We trade carbon every day of the year in the food we produce. In 1985, New Zealand did adopt an ETS. It was an efficiency trading scheme whereby farmers traded poor practice for good by kicking the subsidy habit. The emissions trading scheme on the statute books right now is an efficiency transfer scheme, and that's why we are really angry. New Zealand produces massively more food over the emissions generated. Yes, we're told there was a 12% growth in agricultural emissions between 1990 and 2007, but that was half of that of the general economy's 24%. I repeat, agricultural emissions grew at half that of the general economy. We grew emissions, but we grew productivity and the value to the economy as well. Meanwhile, emissions and population growth are intertwined, as the economy's growth shows. Our growth was substantially less than the 74% for transport and 120% for electricity. 94% of our food is exported, so the prospect of us being forced to produce less so inefficient producers can produce more is frankly bonkers. As farmers, we're being told that we got too good too soon. So what's the alternative? First, let's scrap the ETS and start with a blank piece of paper. That's what our submissions have always said, actually. Try to amend it is a growing disaster. The MMP horse trading is absolute nonsense, and the national government is being bent out of shape over it. The original ambition was to change people's behaviour to use resources efficiently. Now it's turned into a complex accounting exercise and actually is an accounting nightmare, whereby even accountants can't even figure out the figure. Or can't agree on the figure, sorry. Do we have a $500 million deficit under Labor? Or is it the break-even position Minister Smith announced earlier in the year? Or is it this $105 billion blowout by 2050? Would the real figure please stand up? If we do secure the ETS scrapping, then we as a Federation must be prepared to revisit past positions. Federated farmers must revisit things we previously opposed. But my message to government is that we cannot do that with the current scheme or the bizarre lengths being taken to get amendments over the line. So let's repeal it and start anew. Then again, the ETS is all about doom, and you can make a quick buck from doom. Al Gore's An Inconvenient Truth cost him around $1.3 million to make, but it made the millionaire a cool $66 million at the box office. It also helped him win an Oscar and a Nobel Peace Prize worth some $2 million more. Did I say millionaire? Al Gore not only created the popular uplift in fear, in a fear of tomorrow, but then launched a fund that would commercialise climate-reducing technologies. That's really neat. Mr. Gore could well become the first climate variation billionaire. On one hand, an astrophysicist is giving us a 50-50 chance of surviving the next century. On the other, volcanologists are saying Yellowstone, the big daddy of supervolcanoes, is overdue to pop. And if it did, some 80% of life would be wiped out. There's even a movie coming out called 2012. It's about the Mayan prediction the world will end on 21st of December 2012. They don't tell you the time. History is littered, time of day that is, history is littered with messianic predictions of doom. In fact, there have been no less than 220 dates predicting the world's end. The Green Movement tells us unless we do something dramatic about climate variation, then in 10 years' time there will be a catastrophic runaway climate variation. I'm truly concerned about our young. impressionable and easily influenced. They hear these predictions of doom and ask, why bother? Why save for the future? Why study hard? Why do the right thing? We have problems with Gen Y, they say, but that may reflect the apocalyptic future being extolled by the green lobbyists. Psychologically, these dire predictions are sucking aspirations and realism from our young. There is so much negativity in this world, so let us look to solutions. Farmers are reducing emissions per unit of output in spite of policy, not because of it. We are proud to feed the world and cannot understand why our government and sections of society wish us not to. We farm globally, locally. We embrace technology and solutions. We get up, don those gumboots, get cracking in the rain, hail, sleet and snow. Our crops and stock work 24/7. They never go on strike, and neither do their masters. The genesis of our economy is food production from the land and sea. And I have four words of realism: no emissions, no economy. We believe tomorrow will be better than yesterday. But since I started with Shakespeare, I will end with Shakespeare. Farmers, be not afraid of greatness. Some are born great, some achieve greatness, and some have greatness thrust upon them. Thank you.